Yeah. Okay. Well, I hope we have enough room on the card. But we'll find out soon enough, won't we? Okay. Good evening, everyone. It's nice to see you again after a long Pesach break. I hope you had an enjoyable holiday. I think the highlight of our holiday was when my 8-year-old son picked up the roasted egg off the Seder plate and said, "How old is this egg?" I thought we use it every year. Anyways, I want to wish a public mazel tov to Rabbi and Rebbetzin Grunstein, and specifically to their daughter Gitti, who was just married a few moments ago. A very nice young man named Mr. Mandel. The traditional blessing is they should have the merit to build a bias ne'eman b'Yisrael, an eternal house in Israel. Mazel tov. Okay. I'm very happy I managed to get to the chuppah, and with great personal sacrifice, I tore myself away from the Chinese food buffet to be here tonight.
Tonight, I'll invite you to my home.
That's very kind of you. Thank you. But if I have a home, I have to go home and make sure my kids are okay, too. All right, let's go to Emanuel. So tonight's topic is Emanuel Ringelblum, a very, very important, heroic scholar of the Holocaust period. My goal tonight is to tell you a little bit about his life. And, of course, since this is sort of a thinly disguised attempt to offer an undergraduate survey course in Jewish history, we're going to talk about the Holocaust, specifically up until the deportations of 1942. And we're going to focus on the ghettoization period, which is crucial to Emanuel Ringelblum's work. For those of you who are with the college, see, a lot of the students are actually at the wedding, but we have a few of you here as well. I want to let you know, very importantly, we have this new amazing feature called an embedded librarian. If you visit my webpage, you'll find, actually it's on my YouTube page, find a little introduction where we have this great idea. We have a librarian, a professional research librarian. My daughter is signaling, let go of the microphone. Okay. A professional research librarian who is online in the course right there with you. And she's providing lots of information. It's like having a professional librarian sit right next to you in lectures and hand you little bits of information, say, you should look at this article, check out this video, all kinds of things like that. So definitely make use of Ms. Fernandez. She is great and incredibly helpful. Definitely one of the best research librarians I have ever worked with. And I've had the pleasure of working with some really great ones. I'll just tell you one cool thing about her. She comes from Cuba, where she was a professional librarian there, and then she came to America, and she retrained. She received her MLS again here. When she was in Cuba, because they have very strict restrictions on who can access the internet, she was one of the few people in the university who was allowed to go out into the internet. And professors would have to come to her and ask her, what kind of books are out there? And she couldn't like just give them the computer. She had to say, well, what kind of books are you looking for? And she would have to find the materials and filter them to give to the instructors. So she really knows how to dig for information. But let's get to our topic specifically. We're going to look at a great scholar who died in the prime of his career, cut down horribly by the Nazis. He was a young man born at the beginning of the last century, trained specifically in the history of the Jews, specializing in the Jews of Warsaw, proficient in multiple languages, as many scholars from Eastern Europe was. And earned his PhD in 1927 for a dissertation on the Jews of Warsaw, which was later published. But really, the thing that makes him stand out head and shoulders above his peers was his activity during the Nazi occupation of Warsaw. Specifically, he created a clandestine group of volunteer scholars, demographers, sociologists, anthropologists. When necessary, he trained them in the basic school tools of the scholarship, and he sent them out with the simple goal of documenting as accurately and as objectively as possible what exactly is happening in the ghetto. An incredible, powerful record of every aspect of life in the ghetto was recorded by this group, which was called Oneg Shabbat, because they met on Saturdays, and that was the time that they all came together to discuss what they were doing. And although he saw immediately after the rebellion, the Warsaw Uprising in 1943, that their work would be halted by the Nazi onslaught, not to mention the deportations that happened earlier, he arranged for the burial of this massive archive, I'll give you a sense of its size shortly, in three separate caches underground in Warsaw. Two of them were discovered after the war. The scholars went back because there were three survivors from the group, and they found these archives and they unearthed two of them. There's one that's still missing. We're hoping that one day we will discover it. And it gives us a glimpse into the ninth circle of hell that we would not otherwise be able to understand without the tremendous scholarship of Emanuel Ringelblum. So my goal for tonight is to tell you a little bit about his life in particular, and then to kind of ease back the focus of the lecture to talk about the unfolding of the beginning of World War II, specifically on the creation of the ghettos, and then talk about what his archive tells us about ghetto life, and then we'll speak about his legacy. We will not discuss tonight the second half of the Holocaust, specifically the evolution of the final solution, the Endlösung, that was saw the creation of Auschwitz and the death camps. I'm hoping that next week's lecture, when we talk about Evgenia Ginzburg, we'll use her life to talk a little bit about that aspect of the Holocaust. Okay, so why don't we get started here? Here he is as a younger man. He trained with two other remarkable historians whose work also were definitely in the top tier of Jewish scholarship of the early 20th century. Raphael Mahler, who did fantastic work on the evolution of the Haskalah and the Hasidic movement in 19th century Poland. And also Arthur Eisenbach, who did a lot of tremendous work also on the Jews of Poland. He was a non-observant Jew who affiliated with the leftist Zionists, the Pole Zion, the Workers of Zion Party, which is most famous perhaps for their influential development of the kibbutz movement in Israel. Their leader, Boer Borochov, argued that Israel should be both a Zionist homeland for Jews, a refuge for Jews from all over the world, and at the same time, Borochov argued that it would be inappropriate for Israel to be just another country. If they're going to start from the beginning, they should make it a socialist country. And so the Poale Tzion, very influential in the beginning of the century in Israel, later developed into what we call today the Labor Party. Poale Tzion is really the central core of it. The Poale Tzion, like many of the Jewish parties of the time, had a lot of internal conflict, and at one point it split into a left branch versus a right branch. And the left branch was more closely affiliated with the more radical communist elements in Jewish society. And Ringelblum leaned left as well. He definitely believed in a secular socialist messianic vision of Zion. He was also very common for the Poale Tzion members of the time, an intense believer in Yiddish, the Mama Loshen, that was the vernacular of the Jews of the day. Although it was a declining language even before the Holocaust, when of course the demographic impact of 6 million deaths and the majority of them in Eastern Europe, you know, virtually doomed Yiddish, although it is having an interesting renaissance. Maybe we'll have an opportunity to discuss it at another time. You know, many Jews were assimilating out of Yiddish at the time to other linguistic choices, such as the vernacular, be it Polish or German or Russian, in very small instances Ukrainian, or they were being tempted by Hebrew, which was of course the language of the Zionists. And Yiddish was regarded as, they actually called it the jargon. It was not considered a real language except for very serious scholars in Lithuania associated with the Yiddish Wissenschaftliche Institute, or YIVO, which later Ringelblum would associate himself with. But as a Yiddishist, he believed that the language really encapsulated the core values of Jewish culture, that it was a way to express certain things that could not be said in the ancestral tongue of Hebrew, and certainly not in the non-Jewish languages like Polish and Russian and so on. So he was really a believer in writing in Yiddish. He wrote a lot of his scholarship in the Yiddish language, in promoting the formal study of Yiddish through YIVO, which standardized the dialect, for example, and the spelling, things like that. Sort of his philosophical orientation. He joined Warsaw University, and something which kind of pleased me in a way, at the same time he also ended up teaching at a Jewish high school for girls. I know because when I got my PhD and I thought, here I am, I'm a big scholar, I made it, you know, things like that, and then I discovered what some people say is the you know, the most effective form of Jewish birth control, which is day school tuition. That's a joke, thank you. But I'll probably edit that out of the Torah Cafe version. But when I realized how much day school tuition was, then I ended up spending a lot of my time volunteering at local day schools to help offset the tuition of my kids. So it made me feel that I'm in the same family. If Emanuel Ringelblum could do it, well, he's got a PhD at the University of Warsaw, okay, I can also teach day school. As I mentioned, he was very well published, a tremendous scholar, very prolific output. He also believed in promoting scholarship as well. He founded several journals, and he founded a circle of younger historians like Arthur Eisenbach and Raphael Mali discussed it. And he associated himself very heavily with this fascinating institution, which I myself am very pleased to have spent and honored to have spent a lot of time studying with them, YIVO, which was this premier institute of Yiddish language scholarship in Europe. After the war, it was moved to New York City, where it had a place on Fifth Avenue for a long time, right next to the Guggenheim. I had an office there one summer, which was one of the greatest research summers of my career. And now it's in the Center for Jewish History, a little bit further south in Manhattan. One of the most important institutions of Jewish research into Eastern Europe to this day. So now let's back up a little bit and understand what is happening in the larger world and how that affects the Jews specifically in the Holocaust. I'm sure that for many of you this is very basic history, and for some of you it may be very personal history as well, but for the interest of my undergraduate students who will be viewing this for who knows how long on the web, I will just give a little bit of more basic information. So it's important to distinguish between the Holocaust and the Second World War. These were two interrelated phenomena, but they were also quite highly distinct. As one of the greatest biographers of Hitler wrote, Eberhard Jaegel, he wrote that Hitler really had two main elements in his Weltanschauung. In fact, that's the title of his book, Hitler's Weltanschauung, Hitler's Worldview. There were two things that Hitler wanted to achieve. One was he wanted Lebensraum. He wanted living space. He believed very deeply in the mission of the Germans to colonize all of Europe, specifically Eastern Europe, and he would stop at nothing to be able to conquer the entire continent. We'll see that even more clearly in today's lecture when I show you some maps. At the same time, his other main goal, it was not epiphenomenal, it was central to his personality, was anti-Semitism. He really believed in the total destruction of the Jewish people. There's a lot that we could say if we had more time in with regards, maybe we'll discuss a little bit next week, with regards how he came to the idea of ultimately murdering all the Jews of Europe. That was not an automatic and immediate thought even earlier in the war, but nevertheless, he clearly wanted to get rid of the Jews. He wanted this Europe to be dominated by Germany and to be Judenrein, to be free of Jews. He formed an alliance ultimately with several other powers known as the revisionist states. They were so called because they wanted to revise the World War I peace treaties. World War II, as my teacher, Professor Magachi, used to say, World War II is really World War I part two. World War II was fought largely because the end of World War I was not sufficiently handled. The Allies went in at the end of World War I and they assessed blame very one-sidedly on the Germans and the Austrians, and they imposed some really harsh treaties, some tremendous changes to the map, huge demographic inversions where, for example, you would have two-thirds of citizens of Austria-Hungary after 1918 are living outside of the boundaries of Austria-Hungary. Two-thirds of the people living in Poland are not Polish. The capital of Lithuania was located in another country. There were all kinds of crazy things that they decided at the time, which pleased a lot of the newer nations, but the loser nations of World War I were deeply dissatisfied, and when you couple that with the economic crises of the Great Depression, they wanted to fight again. They wanted to revise the peace treaties, hence they were called revisionists. Not, by the way, to be confused with people who call themselves revisionists today. Usually revisionist is a way of saying Holocaust denier. they call themselves revisionist historians. It's a different phenomenon. So anyways, Hitler joined with several disgruntled states, most notably Germany, and for other reasons, Japan. And whoops, there goes my microphone. And he formed an alliance that ultimately resulted in the war, which broke out in 1939. But it didn't break out immediately. There were a couple of really important territorial changes that preceded it. First was, here's a map of Germany, and one of Hitler's first demands was Austria. Austria really deserved to be part of Germany, he said, because it's a common culture, they speak the same language, they share the same, broadly speaking, historical experience. And Austrians, seeing Hitler's tremendous rise to power and the way he restored pride to Germany, the 1936 Olympics was a huge success and so on, so Austrians wanted it as well. And so in a move called the Anschluss, Austria joined with Germany. This is memorialized, of course, in a very famous movie that we love at home, The Sound of Music. I often, when I'm in a good mood, try to think of myself as Julie Andrews, and you know, but I don't want to embarrass my daughters who are here listening to this lecture by talking about that. So anyways, the Anschluss, Austria is joined to Germany in 1938. And then Germany made a lot of noise about the Sudetenland, which are these orange areas here that represent the edge of what became Czechoslovakia and was heavily populated with Germans, ethnic Germans. And the people living in the Sudetenland, the Germans wanted to join Germany, and Germany wanted to take them back. It's also a significant mountain range, so controlling the heights was really important strategically. And Hitler threw a massive tantrum saying, I'm going to take this back or else there is going to be war. And of course, what happened was the Allies, afraid of another war because they'd just gone through this devastating First World War, they followed a disastrously stupid policy of appeasement, in which they said, okay, Hitler, fine, but just this is it, really. We'll just give you Sudetenland, this is it, and then you promise, right? You're not going to make any more demands. So Hitler says, of course I promise, and there's a very famous sad moment when the British Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, we have it actually on film, it's one of those things you don't want to have on film anymore, but it made it on YouTube. He lands at the tarmac in England, and he gets off the plane, and there are journalists all around him, and he holds up this piece of paper, which was completely worthless, saying, I have here in my hands a piece of paper signed by Herr Hitler, and he promises there will be, quote unquote, peace in our time. Or peace for our time. Made a strong, bold statement, and of course Hitler immediately had plans for war. War would bring out in 1939. The way that the last step that Hitler put into place, and this is extremely important now for the Holocaust. Up until now I've been talking primarily about the war, but the Holocaust is a related phenomenon, interrelated. This was the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. Germany, since it's located in the center of Europe, has one huge strategic weakness, and that is that it cannot fight a two-front war. It can't fight actively at the same time in the West and in the East. And that's not necessarily because of the prowess of its soldiers or its advanced weaponry. It has to do with logistics. You can't get supplies easily from one place to another if the front lines are separated by an entire country. So in order to achieve his goal of conquering all of Europe, Hitler had to make sure that one of those front lines was not going to be a threat, so he could concentrate on the other one. And that's exactly what he did with Stalin, his erstwhile enemy, because Hitler was so fiercely opposed to communism. He essentially calls up Joseph Stalin. He says, listen, I want to make a deal. I will send my foreign minister, you pull out yours. It happened that their foreign minister at the time was a Jew named Zinoviev, so they had to replace him with a non-Jew named Molotov. And he said, let's just make a deal. Let's agree to not attack each other, a non-aggression pact. And Stalin says, well, what's in it for me? And Hitler says, listen, what about Poland? You want a big chunk of the countries that were carved out of your territory after World War I, why don't we split the territories that divide us? You get the eastern half, we'll get the western half, we'll be allies forever, and this will be wonderful. And Stalin says, great. So in August of 1939, they signed this secret pact. non-aggression between Germany and the Soviet Union, and that allows Hitler on September 1, 1939, to invade Poland, and the Soviet Union invades at the same time from the east, and Poland is taken off the map within a matter of 3 weeks. Poland is a country at this time very weak compared to Germany. They actually pulled out the cavalry, I mean mounted horseback soldiers trying to defeat German tanks, German air warfare. There's simply no challenge whatsoever, and Poland was simply erased from the map. Despite a heroic resistance that went on throughout the war, there was no way they could hold back the Nazis. The border was drawn, and I'll show you a map where they separated Poland into two. And at that point, once Hitler knew that his eastern border was secure, and of course, France, being an ally of Poland, you know, was upset about what was going on. So then Hitler turned west, and he invaded France. And within the space of a year or so, he was able to conquer Western Europe, with the exception only really of England. And he had just about everything he wanted. France falls almost immediately. The Scandinavian countries go along with him, and so on. So, and Britain, however, managed to hold out for the entire war, despite an absolutely punishing barrage of bombs known as the Blitz, which had children sleeping in the underground. For those of you who are native to Florida, they actually have trains running underground in many other parts of the world. That's a joke. Okay, I shouldn't joke. And that basically takes us up to the division of Poland. I should say one more thing, and then I'll pause for a couple of questions. So this means that by 1940, that is really 9 months into the war, June 1940, France falls, Hitler has all of Western Europe completely to himself, and Eastern Europe is secured by a peace treaty, and he really could have stopped at that point, and he would have had a tremendous amount of power. However, his goal was specifically to the east. He wanted to colonize the east with Germans. And so what he did was, on June 22, 1941, in an act known as Operation Barbarossa, he double-crossed Hitler, and he attacked the Soviet Union. Sorry, he double-crossed Stalin, and Stalin was completely taken off guard. He really thought that Hitler was his best friend, and he would never attack him like this. And Hitler ended up invading deep into Russia, nearly bringing it to its knees. This is especially important for the Holocaust, because this is really the first time that we see mass murder put into place by the Nazis on an organized bureaucratic scale. Again, this is quite late in the war, June 22, 1941. Prior to this, we had what are called Einzelaktionen, single actions from time to time. Perhaps the largest of them was Kristallnacht, which less than 300 Jews were killed. It's a terrible thing, but we're still relatively small numbers. With Barbarossa, Hitler sent behind the Wehrmacht, behind the German army, four police battalions who were specifically tasked to round up Jews living in the little Shtetlach, the little villages throughout Eastern Europe, take them out to ravines, such as shown here in this photograph, and then machine gun them to death. Estimates between 1.5 and even 2.5 million Jews exist, there are estimates of as many as 2.5 million Jews killed by these so-called Einsatzgruppen, or mobile killing squads, including my own family in Lithuania, who were killed this way in Elul of 1941. Ultimately, however, the battle would turn against Hitler, as we know, but that was not until 1943. This map here shows you the extent of the Nazi advance in Barbarossa. You recall, Western Europe is all under Hitler's control. So Eastern Europe, this is the boundary that was drawn by Hitler and Stalin. Then when he double-crossed him, he went all the way out here to this shaded line here. He actually, you can't see it on this map here, but he besieged Leningrad. He came within striking distance of Moscow, you can see up here, and it was only after a really telling battle here at Stalingrad that the Red Army finally managed to turn the tide of the war and eventually press the Germans back to Berlin. Okay, so much to say about this here. I guess I'm going to talk for two more slides and I'll take questions. I apologize for keeping you on hold. What happened to the Jews with this advance? So I mentioned the Operation Barbarossa. where the Einsatzgruppen would go through and round up all these Jews, communists, homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses, other undesirables, and take them out and shoot them. There was a significant movement, however, of Jews to evacuate to the east. Many Jews, once the Germans attacked Eastern Europe, attacked the Soviet Union, many Jews managed to get on trains, on troop cars, and so on, and moved out to Central Asia, where they lived in places like Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and they stayed there really until the end of the war. Perhaps as many as 600,000 Jews avoided the Nazi onslaught by heading all the way out there. So here's a map that kind of summarizes what it looked like, let's say, by the spring of 1942. The green areas here are all under German control, and you can see it goes all the way here from the Atlantic Ocean straight through to Stalingrad here, where they'd be turned around. Also controlled the chunk of North Africa. They controlled the Balkans. Italy was an ally. So really, all of Europe was Hitler's at this point. That's the high tide of his expansion throughout the region. Okay, let me pause now. I'm going to go back to Warsaw specifically in the ghettos. Let me pause and see if there's any questions about this basic history. Yes?
They say that when Hitler and Stalin signed their agreement in 1939, that immediately Stalin knew that he would be attacked by Hitler one day. And he started building up his whole military infrastructure at that time. That's why they did have the ability to make so many tanks. They made a tremendous amount of tanks, even though they weren't as good as the German tanks. Mm-hmm. And they made other munitions also that weren't as good. But the amount that they made overwhelmed the German army.
So I think that's very true in terms of Stalin's personal approach to industrialization. He was really big into massive public works. The dams at Dnipropetrovsk, Stakhanov, and the miners and miners, things like that. So Stalin loved to make all kinds of big things for the public. Most historians nowadays, though, believe that this was just part of Stalin's regular trend to big public works construction. It was not, however, in anticipation of an attack by Hitler. We have lots of records that his generals are saying, you know, Comrade Stalin, the Nazis are doing some kind of funny troop movements on the border. Do you think we should be worried about it? And he's saying, nah, don't worry, Hitler's just doing war games, something like that. And he's completely caught off guard. It's disastrous for the Nazis. Eventually, they were able to turn them back. And the industrial capacity, particularly in Siberia, of the Soviets was especially important to turning that toy. That's also, by the way that America won the war too, because we outproduced them. The sheer amount of munitions that could be made in this country and shipped overseas was, you know, there was no way the Nazis could keep up with it.
But the real reason is for both sides, for the both of these bandits, was the reason to gaining time, because the Russian was not ready. But the Russian had a big advantage that time. They know they cannot come on the railroad because, you know, the railroad track is different.
Yeah, they had different gauge tracks.
So they have to come, and they're waiting when the winter general comes. Yeah. That was the other reason. And to making the help from the United States, and then they're sending thousands daily, daily. And we make here in the Chrysler Corporation 1,000 tanks daily.
That's amazing.
So it was...
Okay, let me take us back.
And Stalin knows what's going on in Europe. Yeah. But they need that time was...
Yeah. That's a possible interpretation as well. Let's move back to Warsaw then.
Sorry.
No, please. No, it's a very useful observation. So what's going on in Warsaw at this point? One of the most significant organizations active in Poland at the time is the American Joint Distribution Committee, which is taking a lot of the wealth that's still present, even in the 1930s in America, and aiding impoverished communities of Jews throughout Europe, really. Ringelblum joined the so-called joint. It was called simply the joint. And he was working on a whole slew of projects of you know, calculating the number of Jews living in particular places and how much matzah relief they would need during Pesach. A very big project was always providing lots of matzah for the holidays. And so he was well-placed, both in terms of his inclination, his training, his experience and contacts, that when war broke out in 1939 in Warsaw, he was naturally placed to be kind of a central figure for the distribution of effort. This would turn out to be especially important for his organizational skills. Now, let's understand what happened in Warsaw at the time. This is what Poland looked like immediately after the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact and the invasion of the region. Poland is this entire colored region here. The pink area was simply taken by the USSR. They had these kind of false elections, and they annexed it, meaning this is now part of the USSR permanently per their declaration. This region here, the Poznan region, or Posen, had a high concentration of ethnic Germans, or so-called Volksdeutsche. So the Nazis simply annexed this and evacuated all Jews here to this green area, which is kind of a mystery for many historians. They used the term general government to describe this territory, which is sort of south-central Poland. They actually used a French term, general gouvernement, to refer to it. And it seemed to be some kind of a cipher government. It was not annexed to Germany. It was not called a military district, like a Reichskommissariat. And even the leaders of the general government, like the, Hans Frank and others, weren't sure what they were supposed to do. But one thing was happening. Hitler kept dumping Jews into the general government and then leaving, essentially, the German administration there to figure something out, do something with them. Contrary to popular opinion, and contrary also in many ways to their to the military organization, Hitler's leadership was very chaotic. He did not like having formal minutes. He didn't like having formal meetings. He would simply kind of like rule by charisma and sort of influencing people and saying, I like you. Go ahead and do this project. And he would just give tremendous rein. So we don't have a lot of real documentation and insight as to how he worked out these ideas, specifically vis-a-vis the Jews, but the general pattern is clear. It seems that this was to be a huge holding ground for Jews from all over Europe, and ultimately when the death camps were constructed, as you can see in this map, Auschwitz, for example, here in Majdanek, they were often in very close proximity to this general gouvernement, which would facilitate the murder of the Jews. So at the beginning of the war, you already have large concentrations of Jews living in the large cities. Most of these cities, Warsaw for example, about 30% of the population was Jewish to begin with. And then you have Jews living in the outlying villages, where again, because of the agrarian nature of the society, the villages are also predominantly Jewish. Sometimes over 50% of the population in a village would be Jewish, but quite often they would hover between 20 and 50% population mark. So there's lots of Jews concentrated in urban and in semi-urban areas. Jews, unfortunately, ironically, in the smaller centers, worried about what was happening in the war, began to gravitate to the large cities, thinking that they would be safer in the large cities. This was ultimately not to prove correct, and it was really in line with what Hitler was thinking of these cities. It took several months, took really until November of 1939, before the Nazis actually worked out a policy of ghettoization. They had not really, they didn't like go into Poland knowing exactly what they were going to be doing with the Jews. There were actually, we have records of the arguments among top Nazis over what to do with the Jews. Some argued that ghettoization was a great idea because it would allow the concentration of Jews. They could be accessed for their wealth, for their manpower, potential insurrection could be quelled much more easily. But there were others who said no, you know, the degree of concentration required would result in a tremendous spread of typhus and other epidemics, which of course was also true. Nevertheless, the voices that argued for the creation of formal ghettos won out, and one by one in the major cities of Eastern Europe, ghettos were declared. Quite often they were, and you can see in this picture here, this is a street scene from the Warsaw Ghetto, where most of our photographs will be from because we're talking about Ringelblum, and they resulted in incredible overcrowding. Like, unbelievable overcrowding. At one point, Ringelblum calculated that in the average domicile in Warsaw, there were approximately 14 people for every square meter. It's hard to imagine how that could possibly be. A square meter is about a square yard. So how can you squeeze 14 people into that space? It meant, obviously, a lot of people were living in the streets. You would have stacked up bunk beds. You have all kinds of things where people were living under tremendous privation, particularly through 1941. Some of the headaches associated with the ghettos were, well, where exactly do you put them? The fact is that Jews, being very old residents of many of these places, tended to live in the downtown areas because they have communities that go back literally 800-900 years. So they tend to live by the rivers, by the central stations, things like that. And that means that in Jewish neighborhoods, you tend to have a lot of important infrastructure. Hospitals, train stations, churches, cathedrals, all kinds of things like this. So how do you simply declare an area totally for Jews when you're going to have to rip out all of the other infrastructure that are necessary for non-Jews? This doesn't show up very well, I think, in the projection, but this is the map of the Warsaw Ghetto. And if you just follow my finger, you see that it has all kinds of jogs backwards and forwards. Sometimes over here it actually has a huge dip in the center, and this represents the Nazis' attempt to create a map of the ghetto that would be acceptable to their administrative needs to contain the Jews, and at the same time appease the non-Jews who were very unhappy to be included in the ghetto or not. You had streets that would run through the ghetto, that were not part of the ghetto, streetcars that were sealed whenever they went through the ghetto, things like that. And ironically, most of the ghettos were not even walled. Most of the ghettos remained totally open, and what kept Jews in them was the fear of betrayal by the so-called Schmaltzovniki, or the greasy ones. These were Poles who would hang around outside the ghetto walls, or the ghetto area, and they would wait until Jews tried to escape by going underground. That was the phrase used. I mean, if you had what was called a good appearance, meaning you could pass as a non-Jew, you would just try to slip out of the poorly guarded walls. You shouldn't have in your mind a picture of like a prison camp. The ghettos were not prison camps. Some of them for sure had walls, but most of them had none, and it was just like neighborhoods, which were highly concentrated. But if you are a Jew who tried to slip out on one of the streets into the broader area, and one of these Schmaltzovniki would accost you, they would demand a bribe on the spot, and if you could not provide it, they would simply turn you over to a Nazi. They'd grab hold of you, a citizen's arrest kind of thing, and the penalties were incredibly harsh. We're talking about summary execution right there on the street. It was a very, very brutal time, not at all comparable to the ghettos in Western Europe. So really, these Schmaltzovniki were extremely effective in keeping the ghettos closed, even when they did not have walls. We'll talk about that when we talk about smuggling. But the ghetto in Warsaw was sealed in November of 1940. Another extremely important element of the ghetto, and by the way, all of the research that I'm sharing with you now is based heavily on Ringelblum's work. All of the details about how the ghetto was built, about how it was sealed, who was in charge, how life went on despite the Nazis, that's all Ringelblum's work in the Oneg Shabbat archives. The ghetto administration is extremely important to understanding how the Holocaust unfolded, and it's one of the more painful elements, really, of the Holocaust history. Basically, what the Nazis would do, and one of the colossal and horrible truths of the Holocaust, is that the Nazis would never have been able to achieve their nefarious goal if they did not have widespread Jewish compliance. If they didn't have a significant number of Jews who just thought they could keep their head down and stay out of trouble, the Nazis did not have the manpower to dominate, let's say, a city of rebels. In fact, when you did finally have a rebellion in Warsaw, it took the Nazis 6 weeks with their entire military might to rout out, you know, really a few handfuls of soldiers, of poorly equipped Jewish soldiers. So essential to the unfolding of the Holocaust is the fact that Jews figured, we'll just go along with this and then it'll be all over. Just keep quiet until the war ends, eventually it'll be okay. And that was a disastrous policy. So in the ghettos it worked like this. The Nazis would use the existing Jewish leadership and communal structure. They would go to the head of the Jewish community, because there was an organization, a kahila leadership. We spoke about it in previous classes. Something like the Federation today, but typically much stronger than Federation, because the kahila leadership would know all the names of all the Jews and their addresses, more or less, and things like that. So the Nazis would go into the kahila leadership. They would say, we'd like to speak to whoever's in charge. The president, the Parnas, would step forward, and they would say, okay, we want you to, for example, turn over the membership lists of all the synagogues in town. We want the addresses of all the Jews in town. Typically, the Parnas would refuse, and he would be shot on the spot. And then the Nazis would then say, okay, who's the vice Parnas? And the vice president would get up, and this would be repeated sometimes 2, 3, 4 times in a kahila leadership until eventually they settled on someone, some secretary or deputy treasurer, who would say, all right, I'll go along with it. In rare cases, you actually have these Jewish councils, they were called the Judenrat in singular, Judenräte in plural, that were actively trying to, you know, promote the resistance against the Nazis, like in Bialystok. But more often than not, the Judenrat were trying to keep the Jewish population alive while complying with the Nazis to the minimum extent possible. Warsaw is an excellent case. The person who ended up becoming the head of the Judenrat there is shown here. His name is Adam Cherniaku, and he left behind a diary which survived the war. And we know a lot about what he thought every single day. He's a very methodical diary keeper. Every day he would record the temperature, the weather outside, and then he would describe what he had to do that day, what the Nazis demanded, Jews coming to him for assistance, trying to figure out, should I comply with this demand, should I not, how do I get the Nazis to stop? And he went through the entire ghetto period until when he realized that his efforts were all in vain and the Nazis were intending to murder all the Jews of Warsaw, he killed himself with a cyanide capsule. But we know a lot about his own thinking because we happen to have his diary. In other cases, we have Judenrat leaders who are virtually war criminals. There's a lot of controversy over one Chaim Rumkowski of Łódź, who took a different strategy. We'll talk about them in a second. But basically, he lorded over the population of Łódź like he was a messiah figure. He had his face printed on ghetto money. He had himself literally carried about in a bier, meaning like people physically carrying him about town. And he treated his position as some kind of king. They called him King Chaim because of the way he held himself. In Israel, immediately after the war, there was a lot of discussion as to if any of these Judenrat leaders or officials were to survive, should they be tried as war criminals along with the Nazis? Very difficult emotional period. Also important to note, the Judenrat was in charge of recruiting, equipping, and training and maintaining the Jewish police. These were Jews who, like the taskmasters in Egypt, would implement Nazi demands to round up other Jews, take them to the Umschlagplatz, steal their valuables, you know, enforce the rules against smuggling and so on. Very, very difficult, complex thing. Yes, Mr. Lax.
Are those called
capos? Capo is a complicated term. That one's usually associated with the camps rather than with the ghettos. But they're in the same kind of category. Two main ghetto philosophies are evident from the historical record. It appears, again, the Nazis did not really spell out what they wanted to happen in the ghettos. So some ghettos, like Warsaw, the Nazi leadership seemed to feel, local leadership, that the purpose of the ghetto was to simply hold the Jews and let them die as efficiently as possible, economically as possible. So there were, for example, actual rations allotted to Jews, but the amount of rations were 150 calories per day. which is an incredibly small amount. That, you know, an adult male needs something like 2,000 to 3,000 calories a day. To live on 150 calories is impossible. And in fact, that would be played out in the ghetto as well. These were called, the so-called, by historians later, the attritionist ghettos, because it seemed that the model was to have the Jews simply die of attrition. Other ghettos, like the one in Łódź that I mentioned earlier, it seemed that the leadership felt, well, you know, we have the Jews all locked up here. Let's do something useful with them. These were so-called productionist ghettos, where the secret to survival, it was believed, it turned out ultimately not to be so, was a cherished work permit. That as long as you had an official permit to work in one of the factories, for example, in Łódź they produced textiles, so they're working on all kinds of like clothing for the German army, as long as you were productive, then you would live. However, as we get to the deportations, even the most productive members of Łódź were to die. In Warsaw, though, specifically looking at that region, the overwhelming experience was one of starvation, of near constant hunger, incredible malnutrition, again related to the tremendously low rations provided by the Nazis, and no normal influx of food into the ghetto other than what the Nazis provided or through smuggling, which we'll talk about in a minute. Malnutrition meant that many Jews succumbed to typhus, a disease borne by fleas, which spread through the ghetto at alarming rates. And there are so many photographs we have. And I've chosen a lot from a place called the Lochame Getaot, it's a kibbutz in Israel, the ghetto fighter's house, where they have one of the largest archives of these photographs, also available through Yad Vashem. And people would simply get tired, lie down in the street, and die there. And there were so many bodies that, according to Ringelblum's research, at one point they were collecting, the public sanitation workers were collecting 150 bodies every single morning from the streets of Warsaw for burial in open pits. In fact, one of the most frightening studies that you have in Ringelblum's work is a study of the activity of the Chevra Kadisha, the burial society, which at the beginning of the war is struggling to keep up with people who were killed in the initial bombings, and then they slowly become overwhelmed and they simply stop digging individual graves, digging large trenches, not filling them up every night because it's pointless, there's just going to be more in the morning. A lot of terrible things associated specifically with starvation. The other end of the starvation was smuggling, and in fact Ringelblum, in a very, very powerful passage in one of his books which he wrote in the ghetto, he says that if he ever had the opportunity to create a memorial for the ghetto, it would be a statue of a little child, because much of the ghetto was sustained by the work of children smugglers who were able to fit through cracks and crannies and quickly evade, you know, Schmaltzovniki, jump around them and so on, to bring back rations from outside the ghetto. Here's a picture of the Jewish police arresting a child who will then later be hung. The child can't be older than 6 or 7 years old. How did the smuggling work? The ghetto had an incredibly ingenious industry of recycling. Typically, people would sell their valuables first, their jewels, their cash, their furs, whatever they could get rid of, they would sell it first. And it would be taken out to the outside world because the ghetto walls were extremely permeable. To give you an example, quite often the architecture in Warsaw has these duplexes where you have like a large sort of apartment building with apartments that faced one street and on the other side facing the other street, separate homes. And so one set of houses might be on the Jewish side of the ghetto and the other side would be on the non-Jewish side. So a simple matter, since they shared a central wall, they can simply break through the wall inside the building between the Jewish and non-Jewish side, put a big closet in front of it. You know, in Europe it's much more common not to have built-in closets like they do in Europe, in America, but they have like boxes that they move. By night that would simply be an open transit route for smugglers. Children would take whatever valuables they had. Sometimes the Jews would actually have little factories going on where they're making especially things like brushes and brooms and recycling things, and they would take it outside of the ghetto, trade it for grain, for foodstuffs, whatever they can, and then bringing it into the ghetto, unless they were caught, as shown here, by the Jewish police. Ringelblum records an incredible diversity of Jewish life in the ghetto. In some places, it is incredibly heroic, understanding what the Jews did in and under these incredible circumstances. Ringelblum included in his archives examples of about a dozen different newspapers written in Hebrew, Yiddish, and in Polish, published in the ghetto. There was apparently a functioning underground Jewish medical school in the ghetto. There was a theater. There was a circulating library. There was an incredible amount of activity where Jews were actually attempting to maintain some kind of normalcy despite the overwhelming tremendum of the Holocaust as a whole. Marriages went on. Here's a photograph of a wedding that happened in the Warsaw Ghetto during this horrible time. And perhaps the most powerful story is the attempt to maintain religious life in the ghetto. We actually know a fair bit about that from one scholar in particular. His name is Shimon Huberband. He was one of the observant members of the Oneg Shabbat collective, and he was tasked specifically by Ringelblum to record all aspects of Jewish religious life in the ghetto at the time. And so we have a huge amount of documents from Huberband describing, going to the Hasidic table of Rabbi Kalonimus Kalmish of Piasechna, Kalonimus Kalmish Shapiro, known as the Eish Kodesh for the writings that he produced that also survived the war. Purim celebrations, the maintenance of mikvaot, and many of these things, by the way, took place in complete defiance of Nazi bans. The Nazis banned the assembly of Jews in the ghetto, and people were going to shul and to daven together. The kind of questions they asked, we have records of them because of Huberband and Ringelblum's work. We also know quite a bit about the resistance, and maybe I should take just a moment to talk about it, although it's really a very large topic. Resistance was a complex and hotly debated topic in the ghetto, and in fact through much of the Holocaust. It seems like there was, to make it very simplistic, there was a huge generational gap with regards to the question of resistance against the Nazis. The older generation, particularly the rabbinic leadership, the established Parnassa, kehila leadership, believed in the strategy that had worked for 2,000 years, which was basically fee or flee. Right? You pay your bribes, and the Nazis will leave us alone, or we run away. We find another place to live. In the case of the Holocaust, neither of these strategies were effective. Hitler was not at all interested in bribes, and of course the Jews had less and less places to run. But nevertheless, the established leadership felt that the best thing we could do is to just try and stay out of trouble. We have to also compound this with the fact that the Nazis were very big into collective punishment. It was one of their strategies to quell the incipient rebellion among the Jews. For example, early in the war, I think it was already November 1940, there was an incident where someone fired shots at a Nazi soldier in a particular street, and then the culprit ran into one of these courtyards that had multiple apartments surrounding it. The Nazis surrounded this, but he was long gone. But they went into this building and they arrested, I think it was 60 men who were living there, and took them away. And they said that they wanted to find out who the culprit was. Everyone in the building said, we have no idea. The courtyard is open. Anyone can run in. He probably ran out the back way. We had nothing to do with it. And in fact, they didn't. They were just at home at the time. And the Nazis demanded a large bribe to release them, something like 500,000 zloty. It was on a Friday, and on Shabbat, the community, of course, overrode Shabbat in order to collect the money, but by the time they delivered it Saturday night, the Nazis had decided to murder all of the men, and by the way, there were young boys in that group as well, as young as 12, simply murder them all, despite the bribe. So this, struck tremendous fear into the population, and the older generation was saying, we cannot stick our heads up. We can't revolt because the Nazis will come down hard on all of us. This ultimately proved to not be a successful strategy either, and the resistance was left to the young and the rebellious who disagreed with the establishment. And ironically, because the resistance that we know, the famous Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, it happened very, very late in the war, after the ghetto was demolished by the Nazis. It was just the remaining few Jews who were living there who said, you know what, if we had done this a year ago, maybe we would have had a chance. Now it's purely symbolic, but nevertheless, they did make a huge impact on world thinking. Oh, the last thing, the Mafia. Thank you for reminding me. And again, Ringelblum doesn't provide us with a kind of like a fairy tale version of these heroic Jews who are trying to make the best of life. There was also a very active functioning Jewish mafia in the ghetto. There was a very lively trade in prostitution, of alcohol. There were nightclubs in the ghetto for people who were able to somehow amass a huge amount of money through these ill-gotten gains. And so there was also a dark, you know, underbelly to the ghetto at the same time. Obviously, highly hated individuals, but nevertheless, they profited off the misery of fellow Jews, even in the ghetto. And these are the details that we get from Ringelblum's highly nuanced studies of the ghetto. To turn back to a wider focus again, the ghettos essentially existed from 1939, fall of 1939, until the spring and summer of 1942. And that's primarily because Hitler decided to work on a different strategy for eliminating the Jewish population that we have clearly articulated in January 1942 at a famous event called the Wannsee Conference. Up until this point, if you'll recall, the Jews were being murdered by mobile killing squads in the east, the Einsatzgruppen, and slowly in the attritionist environment of ghettos like Warsaw, but this was insufficiently rapid for Hitler. And so he directed his henchmen to devise more efficient means of killing the Jews of Europe. An experimental camp called Treblinka was set up in the fall of 1941 to see if gas poisonings would be more effective. And in a report that was presented to Hitler at the end of that year, it seemed that that was going to be the option that they chose. So several high-level Nazis got together at a resort north of Berlin called Wannsee in January of 1942 to sit down and say, all right, what are we going to do to solve the Jewish problem, so to speak. And this is the first clear documentation we have of Hitler's plans to murder all the Jews of Europe. This is a page from the minutes of that meeting, which includes Hitler's plans even to round up the 200 Jews in Albania. There are probably more than 200 Jews on this block right now. So you can imagine Hitler's focus was so minute that he would find even those Jews. And also included the 330,000 Jews living in England that Hitler had not yet conquered. But he, in total, planned at least to murder, it's actually cut off here, but it's 11 million Jews of Europe in totality. And the way that they would do it was through deporting the Jews from the ghettos to six specially constructed camps known in the German lexicon as Vernichtungslager, or destruction camps, sometimes translated in term death camps. These include, of course, the notorious Auschwitz, Treblinka already mentioned, Majdanek, Belzec, Sobibor, horrible places. And many of the other camps, which were originally not designed this way, were later retrofitted, like Dachau, Bergen-Belsen, to have similar functions. But this represents the end of the ghettos, because what happens at this time is Hitler orders the massive removal of Jews from the ghettos by train to the death camps. It begins in January, it begins in the spring of 1942 and extends throughout the summer. The beginning of the decree of the expulsion of Jews from Warsaw occurred on Tisha B'Av, in the late summer of 1942. And that represents the eventual destruction of the entire camp. So Oneg Shabbat is active through this entire period. Oneg Shabbat also has reports on the uprising that occurred Actually, no, it doesn't. Some of the survivors lived a little bit longer, but the archive was closed in February of 1943, several months before the uprising. And as I mentioned, it was buried underground. It was buried in a few of these tin milk containers. These are like, you know, industrial-sized milk containers that would be used then to fill up smaller jugs, I imagine, at people's homes, and in several metal boxes that were unearthed that cover perhaps, well, I don't know, maybe 10 or 12 of these tables worth of tremendous amount of materials. Lots of not only analyses, like monographs and things like that, but also diaries, artwork, children's drawings, the newspapers, incredible amounts of data, raw data that tell us about the actual functioning of this highly abnormal society. And many of them are available online for your perusal. I strongly urge you to look at them. Ringelblum's end, he was taken for forced labor to a camp called Travniki, not one of the death camps, but a labor camp near Warsaw. He managed to escape after 4 months in August of 1943. This is already after the resistance has mounted that huge uprising. And he realized that anyone living in the ghetto is doomed. So he took his son, Uri, shown here, and his wife Yehudis, and they got together with 34 other people and moved into an underground bunker that had been constructed secretly. They lived in incredibly close circumstances for several months, but under these incredibly difficult circumstances, he also managed to finish his last monograph, which was on Polish-Jewish relations during the war. It is now available in English translation as well. He was, however, betrayed. We're not sure exactly who betrayed him to the Nazis, and the bunker was discovered. He and his wife and his young son were killed. After the war, three members of the Oneg Shabbat collective survived. They reported that there was this incredible organization, and they were able to identify two of the caches. Here you can see the unearthing of one of them with the huge treasure trove of documents. So to conclude, here's Ringelblum with his young son, martyred to the Holocaust. Ringelblum's activity represents a kind of spiritual resistance. It represents what Yehuda Bauer, the great scholar of the Holocaust, calls a, well, I'm not exactly sure what phrase he used, but it's a kind of spiritual heroism. It's a resistance, it's a refusal to die at the hands of the cruel Nazi oppressors. Ringelblum wanted to describe what actually happened in the ghetto for future generations, and ultimately he was successful in that very important scholarly endeavor, and as a result of his work, we know more about what it must have been like to live in that horrible time. I thank you very much for your attention and your indulgence, and I look forward to talking to you next week.